So there's no point in trying to beat the algorithm. Google's way too smart, it has far too many people working on this. Chasing the algorithm is an absolute waste of time. So SEO is no longer about looking at all this kind of stuff and then trying to manipulate it. You will never beat the algorithm, it's just not going to do it. You can try, and this is what your search mentioned graph will probably look like. Panda, unnatural links, penguin, and as you can see, further drops in visibility and rankings as this site in particular tried to carry on manipulating. Thought they could buy their way out of an unnatural links penalty by buying more links, and then penguin hit. And these updates will continue to roll out throughout this year, and as time goes by, Google have taken a stance, this isn't going to be reversed, and people need to change the way they do things.
Yeah.
If you have been caught up in any of these penalties, and it is affecting your SEO, the disavow tool is live. And the good news about that is that it works. Now what we can see here is a site that has been hit by a manual penalty when these link network penalties or when on the blog networks were taken down, it was hit with that first penalty. They've struggled removing links for months, and the disavow tool came out and they've used it to effectively recover their site. It does work, you can disavow bad links. Finding those links and disavowing them is another story altogether, but it does work, and it can work if you do it correctly. You can recover your rankings. However, one caveat I would add is that if you have no good links, you're not going to have a chance looking like that, because even once you've disavowed it and Google has given you a clean sheet, you still need to build some good links to rank. This site clearly had them, they just had a penalty because of the bad links they had. But it does work, you can use it. We've worked with probably 20 plus websites and managed to recover websites that have had similar manual link penalties. If you don't remove them, Matt Cutts, Google, will come along and they will penalise you. We've seen it over and over again. They will take the site out, whether that's reducing rankings or de-indexing pages that have been spammed excessively, or if they deem your site to be low quality with their Panda algorithm. Google will do it now. And this is a threat that no one ever sticks to and everybody ranks with spam links. Google are actively penalising. It has to be taken seriously. And the strategy is simple, and it hasn't really changed in 15 years. Have the best landing pages. Have a real reason for people to link to you. Don't just manipulate it. And obviously make sure that they do link to you. Google's view on SEO is you build great content and people will flock it from everywhere to try and link to it. It's rubbish. We still need to do effective outreach. We still need to have a marketing strategy for pushing our message out to our target audience. So, I don't have time to go. I could go through the disavow tool, I could go through penalties in a lot more detail. In fact, I'm doing a workshop at Brighton SEO on it a full day. But if anybody's got any questions after this, please feel free to come and ask me about if that's a particular issue you're going to be dealing with. But let's go through what Google really wants to see. And the first one is page quality. And it's a really difficult one to explain. But you will find in the search results, most of the time, that the best pages tend to rank. The best user experience tends to rank. And there's been a buzzword that sort of battered around for love. Does Google love your site? How does Google understand love, I guess? And the way we think it does it is by looking at user engagement signals. I think it has more than 33% share now of the market with Chrome, and over 10 million websites use Google Analytics. Google understands what a successful site is doing with its users, and then it tries to rank it on the back of that. So we have to make our landing pages. If you've got a page that you want to rank in Google, there is no point in building the worst page in the world and then trying to manipulate it with a load of backlinks. Yes, links are a big part of SEO. If your page is the worst, it's never going to stay there long enough, no matter what links you get to. A good example is the BBC. They use all the Met Office information, yet they rank higher for most location terms. And I believe, as well as having a very authoritative domain, is that their page is better, it's friendlier, they have satellite maps that you can adjust the day and the time, average conditions, they have videos on there, they have the recent weather forecast direct from the TV. It's more user friendly, it's a better page, and therefore trying to beat the BBC with links isn't going to help you. We need to build better pages in order to rank. Building links isn't going to do it on its own. So yeah, so your rankings will not be future-proof based on, unless you are the best page. It's not going to be just based on links. Even if they're good links, it's not going to be just based on links. Historically with Google, we could have the worst page in the world, build lots and lots of links to it, and you would rank. Google wants to get away from that, and this is one of the ways they're doing it. Real assets. Very often we get approached by clients asking us to do some link building for them. And we have to say back to them, we have to tell them there's nothing to link to on your site. It could be a lead gen site, it could be a very thin website with not much content or no real value. They maybe have no marketing activity or PR activity, so nothing to naturally speak about. You have to have assets. You have to have real things happening in order to do outreach and create these links. And every piece of content that you push out there, whether it be on your site, needs to be good quality. If it doesn't warrant a share, the chances are it doesn't warrant a link, whether you're pushing that out as part of your outreach or you're building it on the site. It has to be a good quality piece of content. Worst site in the world with a ton of links is going to stand out like a sore thumb and probably end up getting penalized. And this is what Google are after. They don't want you to manipulate things so that things look natural. They want them to actually be natural. The links we build, what we like to have as a rule of thumb, have to go in front of a PR, MD, or marketing manager and show them that piece of content, that link. And if they want to tweet about it or talk about it, I'll be happy to push it through their social channels. Probably shouldn't be doing it. So if we're doing a link building that no one's ever going to see on the Google when they crawl the site, it's probably the wrong thing to do in most cases. So what kind of assets can we leverage? This is the first thing I get asked when I talk to people about having real things to link build to. No, we don't have anything, what do? Can we not do SEO? I believe every genuine business has something to make them link build. Whether it's competitions that they can run, PR activity, any content they're pushing out, any data or all they can use to make it interesting can be used as a reason to build these links. We have to look at this. We can't just go in and start building links. We have to look at what we've got and what we can use first. Really, really important. And if you don't have anything, you don't invest in any marketing at all, you're probably working in an industry where you have an opinion. You have an opinion on that industry, and that can be used as part of a new strategy. And this is something we use with all our clients across the board, even those with lots and lots of marketing activity and lots of things to leverage. We'll have a brainstorm weekly about what's going on in the industry. We'll shortlist the target sites based on who their audience is, who they want to reach. We'll understand what their opinion is and normally take a couple of quotes from the company that we work with. We'll write some content around it, just newsworthy content, with the quote in the middle, with a link back to the client's website. And we'll push that out. We'll maybe do a couple of copies of the same story with different quoting. We'll push it via social media, and we'll end up obviously it'll get published on the target site. This is, if you feel you have nothing but an opinion, this strategy can work, and you can make your links look very, very natural. The hard part then is finding those other sites to show and outreach to them effectively. But this is a very good strategy for making your links look natural if you feel you have very little to build links from. This is our integrated outreach approach at Brand 3. We look at all these areas, things that are external, things that are internal, and quite often a lot of the assets are already internal. And we put them all into an integrated strategy with the outreach. So if we have a campaign happening, whether it be a piece of PR activity or some sort of promotional campaign, we'll have the outreach team sit down, the PR team sit down, all the teams come together to develop a genuine strategy to leverage links from whatever piece of activity it is. Some examples. We work with Ladbrokes. One thing they did over Christmas was they sponsored the Dart Sport Championship. And there was a lot of things going on PR-wise, but one thing they were doing is they were giving away tickets as part of a promotional piece of marketing activity. And we give them to the readers of various publications, being the Londoners. And we used it to also get people talking about Ladbrokes and leverage links from it. And when we do this, there's not a slide in here about this, but when we do it, we don't care about anchor text whatsoever. What we want is a higher quality link back to a relevant piece of content or relevant page on the client site. In all honesty, as a company, we have an SEO team of 30 plus people now. There is no emphasis on anchor text whatsoever. Yes, we try and use content with the right keywords. Yes, we think about where the links can be positioned and where it's targeting, but we generally have no emphasis on anchor text whatsoever, because we think that's one of the things Google has hit hard in the last 18 months. And it's no longer a strong signal. Here's a piece Virgin did. They are not the best, but it got quite a bit of attention. But they did some flash mobs, some really cheesy flash mobs in stations around London, underground stations. They videoed it. That piece of content then could be pushed out to bloggers. And I think it generated like close to 20 bloggers talking about it, linking to it, republishing the video. So this is integrating your offline with your online. This can also be leveraged for links. SEO, if you have an SEO company that you're working with, they need to know about this kind of activity. They need to know what's going on. They can't just work in a silo, because they can do things with this that will help your SEO campaign. It really is an integrated effort. Another example, we work with a few cinemas, and this was actually a piece placed by the PR team without any links whatsoever. And there is nothing wrong when you've been spoken about or featured in a publication. There's nothing wrong with chasing up on the back of that and asking the publisher to put a link in the article. And if it's on a high authority website, you can also look at who shared that article, because quite often it will be people who have an opinion. And people who have an opinion tend to be publishers, whether on social media or on their own blog or on some news website. And you can outreach to them. So this one published article has generated a list of what, and I don't think this is up to date, there's 78 tweets that we can all do outreach to and find out if they want to work with us on any campaigns that we're working on. We don't even have to do the legwork to find these people, it's all there in the Twitter feed. But this is a really good way, and again, if you're doing PR activity, the SEO company you're working with, or the department, or your marketing department, they need to know about this, because it can be leveraged to get real, genuine links that will stand the test of time. So I guess what I'm saying with regards to how we build links is, there is no point in chasing the algorithm. Work on what's real and use it to leverage what you know Google wants. You don't have to chase the algorithm and use tactics that are there for SEO only. So make sure people link to you. Now Google would prefer to just say, build great content, everyone will come and link to it because it's so fantastic. I've worked with some really fantastic content that never gets linked to. And the reason is because nobody knows it's there. You have to do outreach, and how you choose to do that can differ. You can email, you can pick up the telephone, you can use social channels, but you have to do outreach. If you've got something worth linking to, even people have to know it's there. There's no way to get around it, no matter what Google says. One thing I will say, when you're looking at your backlinks and how to create them and do your outreach and how to come up with a short list of websites, is don't look at your competitors and think, oh, they're ranking okay, and look at all these bad anchor text rich links they have. The chances are that they're probably disavowed. So doing competitor analysis these days is probably not a good thing to do, because you have no idea what links they took Google are basically spam. And if you try and go after that same strategy, you end up penalising your website. So I definitely advise not to chase competitive links. So think about the future and think about what Google have done in the past. Everything that has been created to leverage SEO, everything that has been done so you can get a quick, easy link, is probably going to be no more. Directory links, press release syndication, article syndication, any blatant tactics promote networks are going to end up giving you a penalty. It has to be built as part of your overall marketing communication strategy. It has to be. That's the only way to make it natural. Otherwise, you get to links for no real reason. So when we're doing outreach, we really need to think about why we're doing it. As a team, we have a big outreach team, probably 10 people strong, maybe more actually now. And it would be quite easy just to go out there and ask them to email as many sites as they possibly could in a day, and hopefully something will stick and we'll get some opportunities. But as an industry and as SEOs, we need to think about this. We need to be a little bit more careful about it. We need to think about it a little bit more. Who is going to read it if we push it out there? If no one's going to read it, it's probably not a link worth having most of the time. And who's going to share it? If no one's going to share it, it means the quality's not going to be. And who are the right people to put it in front of? If we have a marketing plan, then we've obviously got a target audience. Why not build that target audience into our outreach plan? An outreach to websites that we know the readers of it are going to be the people we really want to reach. So then we get a link and we get our content, our brand in front of the people that we need to. If I was doing it for brand at 3, obviously I'd want to definitely get in front of Robert, head of digital at Barclays. I want to reach him. It's part of my marketing strategy. Without SEO involved, I want to get in front of Robert. But if I was doing outreach for brand 3, and I was wanting to get in front of him from an outreach inbound sort of way, then I would I would basically stalk him. And I'd look on Twitter to see what kind of content he was sharing. I'd maybe look where he might be publishing content himself. But really quickly, I did this in about 10 minutes. Twitter feed, pulled out the top sites that he was actually sharing. And if I want to get in front of Robert for a piece of genuine outreach that could be tied in with SEO, these are the websites that he tends to share. I know he's reading them, I know he's sharing things on them, so this is where I really need to be focusing my outreach efforts in order to get in front of him. There may be some times when we're running campaigns when it's not in line with our target audience, but that doesn't mean we should have a strategy that runs alongside that does outreach to our target audience. But that's brand 3, and it's very niche, and the kind of people we want to get in front of is a very small audience. So if I was doing it on a much bigger scale, if I had a much bigger audience that I needed to reach, I would go on a tool, as an example, called Follow Along. I don't know if anybody's familiar with it. It's on SEO Moz, it's one of their tools. And I would find who the influencers are. Who are the people? You can do a keyword search, by the way, on this, and it will pull you up all the influencers. In any particular sector you're looking for. This is money saving for finance. You can see how many followers they've got, how active they are on Twitter, and ultimately you can go into them and find out what they're sharing into each profile. And when you find out what kind of things they're sharing, what they're doing, then you can build an outreach list. There's a good tool called Tweet Archivist that will allow you to pull all this information by inputting their profile. So you can see the top URLs they're sharing, their mentions, their top keywords that they're using, the users they're engaging with, and talking about and sharing things with, and it gives you some really nice information that you can use to inform your outreach strategy. And again, half an hour's worth of work, I did this literally last night actually, and you can pull in all these sites. You know they're sharing things on all these websites, so why shouldn't your outreach strategy be focused on targeting these kind of websites? You're getting in front of people who want to save money, if that was your target audience. And these are some of the sites that these people are sharing. You can quite easily build an outreach list of 100, 200 websites to go at, and you know each one of those websites is good, high quality, it's been shared. And you know it's in front of the right people who you think may either engage with your site or buy your products or whatever it is you're trying to achieve. We can still do this kind of thing, just about. If you want to find blogging opportunities, write for us, push your keyword, and it will bring up a lot of blogs that have optimized write for us pages. You'll have to check the quality of those sites really thoroughly, but you can still use it if you want to create a little bit of noise around the campaign that you're running. That's a very easy way to find opportunities to write. I would still say the content you put out there has to be high quality and vet the sites that you shortlist really well. But there's nothing wrong with using that. It's not great, but there's nothing wrong with using it. Ultimately, what we're trying to do is we're trying to justify a link. Why do we have it there? Google will be manually reviewing websites, and when they're looking at them, they will be looking at why you have a link there. What why is it linking back to you, and why is it on that particular site? So they'll be looking at things like relevance, quality of the site, and yes, metrics do still play a part in that. Does it get any traffic, or is it just a spam site that isn't even indexed? Does it have any social activity? Are people sharing things on that website? If it's not, that is potentially a negative signal. And then you have, obviously, is it your target audience? So if you had a link building team, or people who were doing link building or outreach, whatever you want to call it, these are the kind of things they need to be looking at. And ultimately, we need to be saying, would your PR, marketing director, senior people within the business look at that piece of content and give it a green light, give it a thumbs up? If they wouldn't, you have to question why it's there. I'm not saying every time it will be wrong, but you have to seriously question why it's there. And we can apply these same principles with regards to the targeted outreach to the content that we produce. Yes, we all love to use the Google Keyword Tool. It gives us some really good data. But it's not a content roadmap. It just gives us numbers next to a keyword. We don't know how engaged those people are, if they're right, if they're going to convert on the website. It just gives us data. We should be building content on our website and the stuff that we push out as part of our outreach based on the user journey we want the customer to take, whether it takes all these steps or it only takes a few. So for awareness, blogging, posts, news, PR, press, media, all that kind of thing. In terms of interest, we could look at demos and videos and imagery. And then all the way down the line through purchase with locators and location pages, which seems to be a big thing at the minute with Google Venice. And then we can look at retention and advocacy. This is how we should be structuring our content and deciding what content we want to push out. Not just write an article because it has our commercial keyword and we can get a good link back from it. It needs to link into what we're actually trying to achieve with the business. If it doesn't feed into that, it's not going to look natural and will probably, if not now, get penalised on Monday. Every piece of content can be used to justify no links if we take that sort of strategy. Very quality, very, I guess, user journey driven strategy in terms of our content. We can use it to earn links. Videos, we can push them out to blogs and give them to bloggers free. Here, embed this unique video, link back to our site, we give it to you. It's very easy to use it and it's very natural. So I guess ultimately, and I'm just about done, it's about SEO, it's about marketing. This is a piece of marketing activity to drive relevant traffic to our site. It's not about manipulation. It's been easy to do that before and manipulate because it works. It doesn't anymore and it won't going forward. We need to think very hard about our SEO strategies and it's not a part of our marketing activity. So very quickly, just to summarise, I believe the SEO industry, and I think a lot of people do, that it needs to mature. And stop fighting against Google, stop trying to manipulate them, stop trying to get one over on them. They're getting a lot better at detecting this kind of activity. Bad content, anything we're doing for as a quick fix, they'll get better at detecting. So shortcuts will be short-lived. It's about marketing, not manipulation. And you have to develop relationships with industry influencers. I have put a slide on this, but I should really talk about it a little bit. Often the difference, I know people talk about viral content, link bait, but really, normally the difference between something that goes viral and something that doesn't is the people that actually promote it. It could be the best piece of content in the world, but unless you get an influencer to endorse it, you're going to struggle to make it go viral. And how you do that, multiple ways to do that, and you don't have time, unfortunately, to go through it. But you either have to reach out to these people and get buy-in from them, do a little bit of research, or you have to become one if you want to create content that goes viral, if you have that sort of business that lends itself to a viral strategy.